And we are live. Hey, welcome to the Jetty Jet stream. I'm Jet, and you're watching the Jetty Jet show live. And I have some guests with me today. Joining me, we have some pals that I hang out with. What's on Cypress Hangout? Say what's up, John.
What's up, guys?
This is John, our buddy. We're just sketching in. The famous Ricardo. Say what's up, Ricardo.
Hey, what's up, guys?
What is up, guys? Oh, shoot. I gotta pause my sound. It's doubling up. See, So, this is just gonna be a really quick little demo, because I was, asked by John, one of the drawing techniques or comic coloring and stuff. What was the question, John?
I was asking what your technique was for coloring comics that allows you to make quick adjustments on the fly.
Right. So that's basically what. Yes. and I've said this.
That was the essence of it, anyway.
Yeah. You want me to do a quick little demo on my coloring technique.
Right.
Yeah, and I've done that. Am I sharing screens? Can you see the drawing?
I see your face.
You just canceled your the screen you were showing. You just turned it off.
All right, so I think that bring it back.
Yeah, there it is.
Alright, guys, I'm going to hide my mug now. Okay. So I've done this a lot of times on my long hangouts, but they span for like 2 hours, so I know they'll get like hidden and mixed up inside the long hangout, so let's just try to do this, just dedicated to that. Try to breeze through it as quickly as we can. Ricardo, if you would check the comment box, if anybody has any comments. Yeah, and I gotta keep it down because I'm gonna get beat up. Hello, everybody. Casual competitive Jeremy Kerr, Giovian. Glad you guys can make it. Alright, so basically, I'm just gonna do this. Teacher student style. We'll have John kind of just, you know, me and you, we'll have a little. I'll do this basically for you, but basically for everybody too. So, this drawing's for Armor Games, Gemini Strike, the game that I've been working on for so long, and this character is basically the rebel of one of the factions. She's actually a redesign of the character because we felt like maybe the first design that I had was too ragtag. So what I'm going to do is basically color kind of a semi-comic-y style. It'll have all the lights and shadows necessary to convey the message. And it's just a quick and easy way to lay down some shadows and values and tones, and also allow you to change the colors, and we'll get to that. This is the design. She's actually black, so hooray for being cultured. So she was too ragtag, so right now we're trying to design her a little more upscale. She's not like a pirate, she's kind of a, I forgot the term that we're looking for, more of a competitor in the political party things arena. She's got like this trench coat, slightly cleaner looking scarf, Yeah, so I didn't change much. We liked the first pose. So what I did there, I just sketched over it like that. So yeah, this isn't going to be a sketching demo. This is just going to be coloring. So you caught me in perfect moment, John. All right, so as always, I lay down one flat color. And this technique that I'm using right now is, it works in Photoshop, and it also works in Manga Studio, as long as you understand the principle. It also works in Sketchbook, and that's the program that John's using. So, all right, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to lay down one flat silhouette over the character. That's become really popular lately. I've noticed a lot of people doing it. Like everybody's basically doing it now.
Oops. Going back to base, man. That's how Photoshop started.
Yeah.
A comic book artist started in Photoshop doing that.
Yeah. It's really good workflow. It's efficient. It saves you a lot of time. And these are techniques that I wasn't taught. Like, I don't know if this is the official, like, comic book or manga style, but I know it works for me. So I'm just calling it comic book style. Like, you know, if you're like a professional comic book artist and you see this and you're like, man, that's not even right, then I'm sorry. But this is what I do. This is what I know. All right, so I'm just going to clean it up a bit. You don't even have to actually, if you want to, just to get it. Especially since this is still super rough, the character. This is like not refined at all. But it's enough just to sell the character. You know. So quick cleanup. That's that. That's the first pass. Before I even start, let me lay down something that I did for Ricardo. Now, I did the video on like light and color and value and stuff, and that's like coloring a ball. But I need to show you this here. So if this is your form, you have specific components to the illustration. You have the shadow. Alright. As the, I guess that would be, what would that be? The form shadow? Right? And this would be the highlight, the reflected light. Let's put it. This is the local value. Let's do highlight, spotlight, spec light. I don't even know which that is called. What that is called? If you know, guys, tell me.
Oh, sorry.
Specular highlights. Is that what you're looking for?
I don't know. Specular highlight? Is that little white dot? Is that what it is? Okay, specular highlight.
Cool. Yeah, specular. Yeah. I call it how long will this stream be, Jet?
Well, we'll try doing that as fast as we can. I'm just trying to talk about the necessities. I'm not trying to make this like too much of a hangout. So, 15. Pretty much 15.
15. Yeah. Well, let's make it a half an hour, dude.
Let's do it half an hour then.
Yeah, just go easy.
Yeah, we were just here hanging out, and then John, he basically asked me to show him, and I wanted to make it a show so I could knock out two birds, one stone, and put it down for the record. I've got another video. I don't think it was as in-depth, so I'm trying to make it in-depth. Am I missing anything? This is the core shadow. Now this is the... Yeah, there we go. That's what it is. This is the form shadow. This is the local light, specular light, and yeah. I think that, and then warm for the forms. Like this. All right. So, why am I doing this? Because we need to establish the points across so that when you're applying these principles into the drawing, you know exactly what stage is, like which layer pertains to what, and what layer setting we need to have it at to achieve these things. Because we're trying to utilize the functions as best as we can so that yeah, we put it to good use. We got... Oh, shoot. I said shoot. We got the cast. We got the reflected. We got the core. Or form. This is form. Local color is the base color, so it's that gray. Oops. Ah! It would be gray. It would be kind of this yellowish here. Yeah. And that core is the blurred side. So all the stuff you know pretty much, right, John?
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is all review so far. Laying down our principles, our fundamentals, so that we know what we're doing with the layers and people can follow along. And we got the spec highlight. What was it again? Specular?
Yes.
Specular highlight.
I'm just going to call it spec high. Am I missing anything, Ricardo?
What?
Am I missing anything?
No, you're going fine.
For these, because there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, that's 6 points. Okay. Softs, okay. Form. Right. All right, so. Now, how are we going to get all this stuff to do the same thing in our layers? But one, what we're going to do is the form, not the form. Oh, that's what I'm missing. Local. Local. Right? Local light, local color. So local color is basically the flats. If you guys ever heard of the term flats. Flats means the base color of the actual. Somebody farting?
No, it's my chair.
You got the flats.
It's on my Christmas wish list. I'm gonna get a new one.
It's something is farting. No, it's not your chair. It's like.
It's about that.
Yeah, I'm not fit to teach. Show what you can do, it says. Let's see. Flats basically is the local color. And those are the color as it is, like alone. So can you explain for me, Ricardo?
What, the local color?
Yeah, local color or flat.
Yeah, it's just the basic hue without the light bouncing.
Light and shadow. Yeah. It's basically the color of the object. Like, we know an apple is red. What kind of red? Is it an orange red? Is it a yellow red?
It's the neutral tone, too, like the value, right? You're trying to establish what in nature is light and dark, right?
Yes, it's the color of the object.
Exactly.
There, yeah. it's difficult.
But not only color, but value, right? Value, you want to establish like the value too. Yeah.
We also establish value. So what's neat about this? We're gonna first of all create some layers. So we're gonna neat about this is that we can change the colors once we have their colors down. So I'm just gonna create these extra layers. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. I think that's enough. And I'm just gonna start labeling them as I see them. So I see skin. I see hair. If you have any questions at all, John, just like jump at me as we go. The coat.
No, I'm following you so far.
Yep. Scarf. Undershirt. Pants. We'll do the pants. Pretty much the same color as the belt. Let's do belt buckles or medals. Yeah, medals. Get the scarf yet? Scarf. All right. So that's it. Did I miss anything? The medals would be like the buttons, the belt buckle. I think those would be one family of color. Okay, so I'm gonna do that. I'm gonna put them all in one folder, including the lines. Okay. All right.
Can I address a question?
Yeah.
Somebody is asking, is it okay if the flat? Is it okay for the flat to be totally not your intended color to be, or it needs to be close to the final color?
That's a beautiful question. Because if you don't even know your color or what you want, this is ideal for that, because you don't need to know. I can make it puke green, I can make it whatever I want and decide later. And adjust it to fit whatever's on the page. And that's the beauty of this is that it's changeable. And that's why we're doing them on separate layers. Now, if we were on the same layer, you're going to have trouble lassoing and trying to separate the colors from each other. So this keeps it separate so that we can, in the end. So right now, like the hair, I'm trying to choose a color for hair that's suitable, but it's not working. So I'm just going to go with green. I'm forgetting a step. So when you're every color over the silhouette, you're gonna clip mask it. So clip at the layer below. That's the function in Manga Studio. In Photoshop, it is, what is it, Ricardo? You hold on to Control or
you can control click the layer that you want to mask, and it will create a selection for you.
All right, so
in Manga Studio, I have no idea.
No, for Photoshop, you hold your mouse over the very line.
Oh, I don't on Photoshop. I don't use clip masks. I just clip layers on top of the flats. I just do clipping layers.
Yeah, that's
one
what I
top clipping, the other.
Clipping layers. Yeah.
Well, you just have to right click the layer, mm-hmm. and create a new clipping mask. Or just create a new layer and then clip it to the layer below it.
You mean like this? This mask here, like this?
On Photoshop, imagine you have your flats, right?
Yeah.
You just create a new layer above it.
Yeah.
And then you right-click it, and there's an option. Set to clip mask or something
okay.
like that.
Okay, that's one.
And it clips it to the one below it. Yeah.
Okay. So there's that. You can right-click it to get the option to pop up. Also, there's a quick way. I think it's Control or Option, either one. Hold on Control. You hover your mouse over, like first click it, and hover your mouse, and then you'll see a little thing that pops up that basically allows it to mask. Either way, it works. And what clipping mask essentially is it will only color on things that it's below it, and that's the.
Somebody's saying that's alt click between the layers.
That's what it is. Thank you. It's alt click. Yes, it's not control click at all. It's alt click between the layers. Thank you. So alt click between the layers. So if you have these two layers here, hold R alt, and then move your mouse, and you'll see, you just click right between it, and the one on top of it will turn into this red line, which is clip masked. So right now it's not clip masked, and if not, do this, and you'll see it go out of the layer below. But if I click it on, it stays like that. So okay, we get that out of the way. Clipping mask. So that's gonna be skin, and it's gonna clip there. I'm gonna clip mask the hair. Oh shoot. Yeah. Alright, so clip mask that.
And no, it is all click.
Hmm?
My bad. It is all click. I'm working off of a Nostromo gamepad, so I always confuse my Control Alt Shift buttons because I don't actually see what I'm clicking.
Okay.
It's just habitual.
Right, right. No, I haven't used Photoshop for so long. I used to always do it. How can you get it for anime? Shoryuken asks. Well, why don't you read it, Ricardo?
How can you get your flat colors down quicker? For example, cell shading for anime. Well, you have two ways of doing your flats. You paint it, or you just use your selection tool. No, how the hell do you call it? Yeah, the quick selection tool, right?
Yeah.
Just create. Just select everything you want to be flat, and just pick your bucket and fill it up.
There's
quicker way than that, I guess.
Yeah, if you're talking about how do you select, like find the colors that you want, like what colors to choose from, that's going to require color theory. A quick way is pull a picture off the internet of that character, whatever you're drawing. Take those colors, like just colors, like straight off of those colors if you're having trouble. Or take a photo. It doesn't have to be that character. Give me a photo of like the forest, and then since those colors are all balanced and harmonized, you can color select from those and use those as your own colors.
Well, I'll tell you, like, one of the things that really helped me to understand shading, if I can like interject for a moment, I pulled up like actual photos, and let me find an actual like photo to open here so I can show you what I did. Give me two seconds here.
Is that the one?
Pulling something out of my reference library. No, it's not the one. I just opened that so I could figure out how the what I was doing for clipping mask.
Mm-hmm.
Let me see. Oh, it's been a while since I've actually updated my reference library for live models.
For some reason, this is really slow. Present to everyone.
Yeah, let's try this. So what I would do is I would go in and like say I would like look at her hair here, and I would go in and alt click and just bounce around for a while and see how like the highlights and the shadows kind of like bounce around on the color wheel. So you can see how those colors warm up and how they cool off, depending on whether it goes from shadows to highlight. Like, not only just looking at seeing where it bounces around inside of the colors, like as far as the hue and the saturation value are, but also, or not just seeing how, like, you know, light, dark, saturated, desaturated it is, but seeing how it bounces around on the hue wheel as well, could really help anyone develop an understanding of how light warms and cools a surface, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it makes sense, and it will help you with picking your colors. So that's a quick way to get your colors, and let's go back to, so I got the coat, they're not be the final coats, but I'm just choosing the coats colors. And you can also use Paint Bucket tool for Manga Studio. Pretty sure you can use it for all the other ones too, but this is how you do it for Manga Studio. It's nice because you can choose the lines as to be the reference layer, and that just means like all the layers below it will respond to it as if there's lines on that layer. So I'm on the scarf layer, there's nothing there, but since I've set the lines as a reference layer, I'm going to fill it in like this. That's one of the unique things about Manga Studio. It allows you to do that, and it's really effective for comic book art. But notice, if you turn off the lines, you'll see spaces between like the lines that it didn't touch. So, does that make sense?
Yeah. Could you go just real quickly touch on that one more time, because I was looking at something else, and that was actually one of the things that I did want to ask you about.
Okay.
But you can go over it on the next part, whatever it is that you're doing.
All right. Yeah. Let's do that with her shirt or jacket, whatever it is. Yeah, undershirt. Oh man, somebody cast today. Can you hear it? It's like,
wham. Yeah, it looks like feedback from a microphone or something.
Okay. Alright, so what I'm doing is I'm using the Paint Bucket tool, and it is basically filling in all these colors. I think it might be yours.
Mine?
John.
What?
It might be your something's like, if you're not hearing it, it's you. But it stopped. Okay, so for the lines, you're gonna set that to.
Is it back?
No, it's not back. It's gone.
Okay.
Yeah, the lines set to reference layer, and that just means it's treating the layer that you're on as if it's on the line layer. There's nothing.
Okay, so that is a Manga Studio thing then.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because I see people doing it in like Photoshop, and I see them do it in the sketchbook, and every time I try to do it, it just gets all jacked up. So I'm trying to figure out. No, I don't have Manga Studio.
There's no reference layer, I don't think, on Photoshop. Not that I'm aware of. So yeah, like for example, pants. There's nothing for pants. I'm just going to go this color. I'm going to fill it up. I turned off the reference there, I think. No. Oh, no. The reason why it spilled out is because there's this gigantic hole there.
Mm-hmm.
Gigantic hole, just cut it off like this. But I need a different color. Let's do purple. Cut it off by painting it in like this. Get the other leg in here. I didn't draw it in.
And you're using just strictly a hard edge brush for this? Like if you used a soft edge, would it create artifacts?
Yeah, that it would really, really create like all kinds of edges. Like it wouldn't fill in properly. Like if I were to do this. Or to do this, and then people have seen me do it before too. Like if I did that, and then I went to the Paint Bucket tool, you see those broken up pixels? See that? But so we have to use kind of a really nice hard edge ink brush of a sorts. Anything that's just stark. Nice flush, even. And that's why they call it flats. Everything's flat, flat, flat. So there's no artifacts. In Manga Studio, it also is. It's the same for Photoshop, but for Manga Studio, if I turn on the scaling, it leaves space. See, it knows the space between the lines in the board, like so. That's what that is. That's really useful too. and I can keep pressing it until it goes through, or just go ahead and paint over like that. Let's just do it all the way up to the belt. Figure that out. Later. So right there, it's not hitting this part, even though I went over it. It's because the flat underneath doesn't have anything on it. And at this point, I'll just color it red over like that. If I wanted to pick that color from that layer without having to turn off everything to go find it, well, it's right here. So I can just use that. I just can color select it. But if, for example, I can't see it and I want that color, so I'm on blue, right? If I'm on blue and I want that color, I'd go to my selection tool, color selection, and pick up from layer. They have the same feature for Photoshop. So if I click on the purple, it should pick up the gray, this grayish color, not the purple. See?
Mm-hmm.
Did you catch that? Let's see if we can get that again. So if I'm on purple and I choose the selection tool and I pick from layer, right here, look right here, just keep your eye on this. I'm going to select from layer. See how it turned gray instead of purple? Anyways, that's that. If you needed a quick way to select whatever's on that layer specifically. Metals, let's just do yellow. Yellow, flat. And all the colors, they are all... there's a hierarchy to the colors. So whatever's the topmost colors should correspond to the layering order. Like whatever's on top will be on top, like visually. Physically on top, it is physically on top of the layers. Common sense. Scarf, did I? What?
It's kind of like when you were in elementary school and you would make like little cutouts from what was that damn construction paper? That's what it was.
Yeah.
And you would, you know, I don't know if you ever did that in like in elementary school, but you would cut out a little man, cut out pants, put the pants on top of him, cut out a shirt, put the shirt on top.
Yeah, it's the
take it home to mom.
Yeah, that's a good analogy. Yeah.
Well, they used to do it. Let's do some golden gloves. Golden gloves. I think I'll keep this for skin. Like the skin. Yeah, it looks horrible, right?
you can pull it off. I mean, just... are you doing it... the flats on the same layer?
No.
You're doing a layer for each one.
I've already got a layer for everyone. And I'm going to be
modify. Play with the the hue of it. Maybe turn it a little bit brighter, a little bit.
That's that's the point of it. I'm just saying I'm going to do that right now. I'm about to do that.
It will still work though if you worked it.
What? Oh, the
value on top of it. Yeah, I think you can still pull it off if you wanted to.
Oh yeah, I think so. But I have a specific color scheme from the actual client, so they know what they want. All right, so let's get the colors according to what they wanted. The scarf's gonna be white-ish, really bright. So Control U to get up the hues for Manga Studio, and I think that's the same for Photoshop, right?
Yes.
Okay. Good. So I'm gonna go more yellowish. I like to have a warm white there, and I'll turn up the value like that. Just hold it up to white, and that's the color I want there. I'm gonna do that. For the coat, we wanted kind of a beige too. Like, that's what he meant by like it's too ragtag. We want it to be more a little more. Sophisticated. so yellowish. Her hair, we'll do. So this is one way of selecting your colors. I'm going to show you another way of doing it. Right, now let's do... Yeah, that looks cool. Let's desaturate a bit. Yeah, it went. Another way.
No, I like that color.
Undershirt, thanks. So if I go on the undershirt, I'm not going to go control U and get this hue saturation thing. What I'm going to do is lock it. So lock transparent pixels, and the same function applies for Photoshop. And that is basically on the layer you're on. You paint basically only on areas that you've that's on that layer. So on the undershirt layer, we only have this baby blue here. So we have a color over here, nothing happens, but if I'm in here, it only touches that, so it doesn't touch anything else. So that's another way of applying color.
Oh, I would like to, if I can interject again for just a moment. I think it's important to note, in Photoshop, I don't know about Manga Studio, but I do know that in Photoshop, if you select like a gray, if you select a value that doesn't have any color in it whatsoever, whenever you pull up the hue saturation slider, it has no hue or saturation to adjust, so you're stuck with gray. So
no,
it's kind of important.
No, you can colorize it.
There's going to be a little checkbox in the bottom. So if you're trying to switch it around, if it's completely gray and you're trying to change colors, you can't until you click this button that says colorize. Once it's colorized, you just slide it around, and that'll help to fix that, pointing that out.
That button, basically it just attributes a color to it, like a random hue, and then you can change it.
Yeah, and it's the same
what?
For... Yeah, it's actually the same for...
Yeah.
And the only problem with Manga, that's actually a good point too, because in Manga Studio, they don't have that feature. So, let me show you if I can with her pants. Let's change her pants completely desaturated. Right, so now it's perfectly gray, okay? And I turned off the hue. Now if I go back to the options, it won't change. See? It will not change. You can change the values. Values is the brightness of the color. But you cannot change the hue. So this is where the lock transparent feature will come in handy if you want to fix that. You're going to lock it first, and I think that's what you were hinting at, John, when it's locking. When you lock it, then you would go in. So yes, what you're talking about applies completely for Manga Studio. You want to lock your transparent pixel first. You're like, crap, I can't change the gray. Lock your transparent and then change it. Just paint over it manually. Like that. Okay, and then find your color. All right, let's find her color. I want a little darker color for her pants. Desaturate it down. Let's go. Yeah. Our gloves. I don't want these colors. What color her gloves should be? They didn't say the color of the gloves because she didn't have gloves like that. Oh, let's try red. She has a red undershirt, red gloves. Brighter. That's that. Let's color her eyes. Because I don't have a layer for eyes yet. We'll make a layer. And for eyes... Oh, let's do her eyes kind of gray for now. Alright. And we can use just a white If you're using white, normally you want to keep your whites on a separate layer, but since it's pure white, if I change the color, it won't be affected. So I can just change it like that. I do want that slightly greenish blue, but I want it more desaturated, so like that. That way it's kind of a grayish color. Now this is where that white part comes in play. If I'm turning down the value, it turns down the white too and it screws it up. That's fine. I'll just open another layer on top of it and paint the white over it like this. Ba-da-up. Bow. Change no more. Let's label these before we get confused, because if you're dealing with a lot of layers, you're going to start getting confused. Changing that. Let's turn the saturation back up. Bluish, greenish. Yeah, greenish blue. There. That. Now, as I'm doing this, I'm also thinking about values. If you squint your eyes, if this was all black and white, let me show you what the pattern is. So I'm going to create a layer above everything. This is a color theory demo, but... Alright, so I'm going to adjust the hues over all the colors. And you would right-click or control-click and go to New Correction Layer and go to Hue Saturation. And then desaturate everything. So we're getting light hair, dark skin, light eyes. So dark, light. If I'm light there and I want the next color in the scarf should be light, lighter. If it's not lighter, then it should be darker. So darker than the coat. Undershirt has to be darker. And if whatever's under that has to be even darker than that, that's the skin. And whatever's underneath that has to be even darker. So right now the pants is borderline the same value as her skin. What I would do there is just adjust slightly for the pants. Just to separate values. And your eyes can read it a little better. And this is what this comes first. You should be able to do this first before you should worry about colors. Value scheme. Your value scheme. Black, white, black, white, black, white, dark, white, dark, white. Just so that nothing blends with each other. And then, so I can turn it back on now. So now we kind of have a better working scheme going on. Now, right now, colors are still kind of hectic. And if colors are hectic, what you can do a lot of times is just desaturate everything. So, for example, her undershirt. It's just too saturated. Let's just desaturate it. Desaturate that, and it pushes it back. Her gloves, too bright. Too bright. Let's just desaturate it. Desaturate it. Desaturate it. Choose a different color, even. And the colors. And darken it a little bit, since it's against a light coat.
Jeremy asked a good question, but I think somebody answered it. He asked, what's the point of putting in a flat gray in the first step, even though you're going to put another flat layer on top of it? Is it okay to put in straight on the colored flats? And the short answer to that is yes, but in the long run, it's a good idea to put a flat gray layer underneath in case you want to select the entire character, to like maybe apply a gradient mask over top of it, or if you want to lighten the entire character, or if you want to darken the entire character. There's a lot of benefits to putting down a flat for the entire character, as opposed to just having everything separated.
You're talking about the first layer that
yeah. Yeah, the base flat layer. So
what did he ask?
He asked if there was a point to putting down a base flat, and why not just is it okay to put down just the flats for all of the colors?
Yeah, it is. It is just the purpose, I think the purpose of this technique is just to save you time if you want to change everything and didn't have to.
Right.
Another thing about the underneath color and then not having everything over is that it will cover the holes. See this? There are holes. Right now we're using a light blue flat silhouette. So instead of that, we'll use a red. Red's a nice dark value. I used to always use red because that's the lowest key. It has the lowest color key on the color spectrum, so it reads as a darker color. So if I pull it down and use red, it will fill in all the gaps that you miss. And that's one of the reasons why you can have it there. Brown, whatever, there it is. To isolate it, I think for Among Us, you hold control. No, alt. No, functional. I don't know what it is, but for Photoshop, I think it was like option or something. If you pressed option, control, or command, whichever one it is, it will isolate and turn off everything else except that color, that layer's color. You can see what's on that layer.
I don't know that one.
Might want to try it. Can you give us a...
Yeah, I got something pulled up here.
Which layer and which key was it? Do you know?
I'm looking.
All right.
Find something here.
It's fine. Yeah, if you find it, just blurt it out. Scarf. Let's brighten it up even more since it's not bright enough. Starting to blend in with the coat. Let's darken the coat a little bit. See, I'm playing with values again. We can brighten it up a bit. Change it warmer. Yeah. All right. So now everything seems to be saturated. Let's choose one thing to make it really saturated, and that should be the undershirt. So it's back and forth. It's not like I know these colors. Like, oh, this should be this color, this should be that color, like right away. I'm experimenting. I'm slowly. It's all color is all relative. That just means it depends on what's next to it. Then you can find out what color you want. Depending on what's next to it. But there are also very popular color schemes that are common that you see, and you can always fall back under those color schemes. Yeah, that's that. So I don't want any repeating colors. Like if the gloves were this color, I don't want her hair to be the same exact color. That's just weird. Like, why is your hair the same color as your gloves? Okay, let's just see what color I had for before. It was really dark. Yeah. Skin. Yeah. Saturated a bit. Everything's pretty much warm. Yeah. All right. There, we got our flats. I'm satisfied with this. Probably gonna go in and adjust it a little bit more when I'm done. But for the most part, it's pretty okay. I don't know how else to put it. Yeah. Oh, the metal. The metal for her bell buckle is too much. Let's just do gray. Yeah. Green, gray, blue. Blue is gray. Gray, yellow.
Purple.
Fuchsia. Oh, I'm hearing voices now.
Magenta.
No, that's not good.
Okay, fuchsia.
Oh no, I'm gonna go there right here. yeah, let's just go with that. Okay, let's get on with the fun part. So, this is where all of this stuff will come to play. Well, it already started with the flats. We're gonna move on to our next, which is shadows. And which one? Cast shadows, form shadows. Shadows. Now this is something that I showed Ricardo, and it's become really popular. I think it's called the occlusion shadow technique. I don't know what the hell it is, but it's just what I do. And there's two ways of creating form shadow. You can either manually paint it in using your soft brush, painting it in like this, like that, getting the shadows in there. You know what? I'm using black, so it looks stupid. But okay, this is why we put everything in one folder. It's because I want my shadows to affect all the colors underneath. Now watch this. If I had this over here, over the lines, this is our lines. Let's label the lines. Then I have the shadows above that. Shadows. If I had it just above that and I clip masked it, I will only affect the lines, which is a cool effect if you want to mess around with that. Which I do. No, I don't do it. I don't do it that way. What I like to do is I'll go to the lines, lock the transparent pixels, and get a dark red for the lines. This is good for finishing your work. This is a rough draft, so it doesn't really matter, but if you wanted to, you can put a redder tone to your lines just so that there's no blacks in there yet. Because the blacks tend to cause a lot of contrast. You want to reserve your contrast, hardest contrast, for your focal point. So that's just going to be all reds for now. Okay. So that's how you change the color of your lines. Okay, so the shadows. You guys saw what I did with the shadows. It only affected lines. Now I want to affect all the colors. I'm going to put above the folder. Now it affects whatever's in that folder. Okay, so I'm going to go like this. I'm going to choose a brown for my shadow. Oh, shoot. And I'm going to turn it into multiply. See? Now I got some form shadows. Now, this is going to look really shoddy if you're not really familiar with where your light sources are and stuff. So, really good technique is just get a nice hard brush. Paint over everything like this. You can also paint bucket fill everything, but I don't want to fill up the whole page. So just start with everything filled up like this. And now we're gonna mask out. Click this mask. Create layer mask. Whatever you paint on that layer mask.
Hey Zeus, he's using Manga Studio.
Yeah.
Yeah.
in Photoshop, your layer mask will be to paint out your layer mask, you're gonna paint black over that white area. Like that, you would paint black, and it would start to take out whatever's masked. In Manga Studio, we erase. So we use this eraser function here, or use the eraser here. And I'm going to create my form shadows. Now, just like with this bowl, light emanates from the center out. So I'm going to find out here. Right here. I'm going to hit here. Just quickly here, like this. Here. Let's just put our light source. So we're going to say the light source is coming from up here, right? For the ball, it's going to be, oh, let's do this. Let's do this. The light is right here. So if it's the head, it's here. If it's the hair, it's here. If it's the hair, it's here. If it's the shoulder, it's here. So it repeats itself over and over and over here. Oops. We used a less soft edge to brush. So here. I'm using a brush tool that's giving me this effect, which I like very much. Here.
What tablet do you use, Jet? Is it in Intuos 4?
Intuos 4, yes, thank you for that.
Yeah, somebody is asking if it's a good idea to get one.
Oh, it's a very good idea. There's a special going on in Wacom right now. You get Manga Studio and their pad for like $100. Man, I should get paid for that. There's some light here. So like, okay, look at this. This is a ball on her face.
Literally. Whack and plug.
Yeah, I'm plugging them all. We all do. All of us artists do. We don't realize it. It's like free advertising. We just circulate it.
You almost hate to say it, but they really do just make just excellent products.
Yeah, no, they do.
I'm so close to buying a Bosto just to see if there is a competitor for Wacom that is real. So close.
Yeah.
But...
yeah, Photoshop. I mean, Wacom's are the champions right now. Their product's so expensive too. But that deal with the Manga Studio, that's a damn good deal. Man, that line right there is bugging me like crazy. She like got tattoos and stuff on. So I'm essentially erasing out my shadows. That's what I'm doing. In Manga Studio, you can use your whatever brush. If it's a spray can, this is called the transparent pixels function. So you're essentially erasing using the tool the brush that you're using. So you erase out the arrow using that. In comics, you'll see a lot of these really large gradiated colors like this, so we'll do that for purpose of example like that. We'll do that.
I think I might try to adopt this technique of painting out the shadows as opposed to painting them in, because usually I paint them in, and like whenever I'm painting something in, I tend to go real heavy on it.
Oh yeah. This is why this works so well.
I can see this working.
You pull it out. Yeah. So like, if you're using a big old round soft one. How quick and easy you can achieve this kind of lighting effect. It's blooming, and it's covering big shapes before you even worry about where exactly the shadows are hit, like what crevices they're making.
Right.
That comes right here, our next color. So right here we're doing form shadows. And the next one we're doing clip mask set. What are we doing?
Flat shadows.
Cast shadows. Flat cast. Either way works. Okay. Okay, so I'm gonna cast pretty much art flat, cast shadows. Now here's the beauty of it. The brush tool here generates a lot of nice variation in the lighting. But to simplify it, since you're gonna have to deal with so many comic pages, you wanna simplify it as best as you can so it's quick and fast. So I'm just going to keep it nice and generic and blooming. And that's why that soft brush it comes in handy. If you have time, you'll have a large number of pages to do, and your brush, you spend all day just using that brush. So it'll be nice and pretty. But since comic means we're pressed for time, we're going to use that big old stuff. Next one, cast. We're breaking it all down into separate. Yeah, but that's not hair, by the way. That's going to be a little mechanical thing that attaches into her head. I'm going to change the color later. Eventually. Okay, back to this color. I'm going to multiply it. So now we're going to cut into areas where we want cast shadows. This is one way to do it. I'm going to show you guys another way in a second. This is... Oh, I like to do it. Okay. So I'm just creating these cast shadows, and they contrast against the soft ones. So I'm building these shadows right there against the...
Now, do you always use just a straight flat brush for your cast shadows, or...?
Yeah, pretty much.
Because everything else looks a little soft. Like, even your lines look a little soft after you, like, colorized them.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, what I'll do is, the shadows, if you're talking about graphic, you know, they're really just one, two-step approaches. If you want to begin to render it out, you can, blend these shadows in, and I'll show you what I did today earlier. The champion. Let's see here. So this is the champion.
That guy's awesome.
Thank you. So, like, if you notice, these are some cast shadows that I posted on him, but I'm beginning to blend it in. That's after I've laid them down. So, some areas, like here. This is 1, 2, 3 values. Before it was just this 1, 2, this dark to light. But then blending going on in here. And I don't fuss with it too much. It's really quick. Really quick. But they are all in stages.
So okay.
Stick to your stages.
So the short answer is we're getting to it and I should be quiet. Gotcha. Oh,
We get to it. It comes down to how rendered do you want to get it? You know what I mean?
Yeah. Oh, do you mind if I ask you another question? Like, not to distract too much or anything, but do you like change the color of your lines any at all, or do you leave them like that? Are you gonna leave it like that red?
I like that red. I can go back to black if you want.
No. I mean, are you gonna do not change overall, but variation, color variation.
Not so much for the lines, especially if it's comics. You know, like it's usually flat black, stark lines, thick and bold. Because again, it's time is money. So, if you want to create some sort of effect, yeah. But since it is just comic, I'll just keep it one color. I'll keep it to red. So there's some shadows here, some cast shadow here. I like to just cast shadow the heck out of one spot. Whatever it is, choose it, figure it out. Nice, bold shadow always goes a long way. It keeps your drawing from looking spotty. If you're only doing these little ones here, that's nice. But if you do a large, broad one, that really, really shows you where the light source is. It's a really strong light source. And I wouldn't do it here. No. That would mean that it's really turning in like this. Some here. Here. And it's also the same for this ball. It's going the opposite way. There's a big, bold cast shadow. So this cast shadow is turning into the form shadow. This here is part of this. Okay, some of that there. Yeah, no, John, don't say you should keep your mouth shut, man. That's what you're here for. You're asking the questions most people are wondering. That's what would. It's good.
Jesus, I'm gonna interrupt you again for just a second. Jesus, the Wacom link for the Intuos 4 is broken right now, so you'll just have to check later.
Oh. Yeah, man, check it later. All right. So, I'm spending too much time. It should be very fast and quick per stage. Let's add the cast shadow for the back of the scarf.
And Shoryuken Dude is asking, how do you get such blended smooth gradients between your colors? I saw you put down flats and then the highlights, but how do you smooth out the transitions? I think he's going to get to that.
Transitions? I think he thinks what I've already done has accomplished a transition already.
I think he's talking about what you were talking about earlier when you went back to your other one, how you blended in the shadows.
Oh, for the Imperials? The Imperial Champion?
I think that's what he's talking about.
Well, if he's talking about that, I'll get to that. But if he's talking about what I think he's talking about, there are the soft gradients form that are all blended.
Yeah.
The big round.
Did you use a color dodge or something on those yellows on their coat?
No, not yet.
No, I think he just laid down the soft.
It's a big old soft brush. Just soft.
Yeah.
Soft.
Well, I think that's what he's asking.
Okay.
You have those highlights, those yellow highlights on the coat, and then it transitions to darker values.
That's from.
And I think that's the.
Yeah. Whichever way. Oops. Yeah. Ah. Stop moving. What happens if you're clicking your clicker at the same time as you're coloring? What's that? Okay, I'm spending too much. See, I get like caught up with it. Forget. Just gotta move on. I have to. Right now, it looks like 50-50 shadow light. Remember, I like 30. It's gotta be 30. 50-30. Rule of thirds. Rule of his elves.
Wait, right. What is that? Did I miss something?
is basically the idea, the principle that whatever stage you're at, your element should encompass 30% of the object. It should only... Okay, so if we're on shadows...
Sorry.
No worries.
Ricardo, don't die. Thank you.
If we're on shadows, we got 30% shadow. We got... I can't do math. 70% light. Roughly, visually.
Can I try and explain it?
You explain it, please.
It has to do with how you lay out your attention spots and or your details or your colors or your shadows. It has to do with having resting points between your details or your focal points, so your eye doesn't get lost. It has room to rest, and then it gets back to those 30% that matter. Did that make sense?
Mm-hmm. So here's another one.
Yeah, so we're talking about this in regards to light, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Lightning can be line, it can be form, it can be shape, the whole way through. Like, okay, for example,
okay. Well,
this is form, right?
I really want to play devil's advocate for a second here.
Go ahead.
But so going by that rule of 70-30, like if you were going to apply that rule to light, wouldn't that imply that a light source would be in a constant position or at a constant angle at all times?
No, it's just, you're composing the image, right? You want, this is for the image to turn appealing. It's not,
Now, if, for example,
it's induced, it's worked, I mean, it's you can search it no, go ahead, Jen, go ahead.
Here's how I explain it. In nature, everything is composed of the rule of thirds. If you look in the spiral of a flower or seashell or the structure of our anatomy, the way our arms are divisioned, the way the light hits things, it's basically the mathematics of life.
You're talking about the golden ratio.
The golden ratio, not just the golden ratio, it's also the Fibonacci sequence. It's the way numbers just play out in life, the rule of pi. Now, in art, my theory we are basically translating it in a visual form, and we're trying to replicate it the best we can. So, when I say rule of thirds, it doesn't mean it has to be 70% light, 30% shadow. That just means like, if this is the angle of light I'm choosing, then that's how much it is as an overall statement. If I'm going to section off, for example, if I section off this portion here, oh shoot, I'll be on top of the layer so I can draw over it. If I were to section off this portion here, 30% shadow, 70% light. If I section off this portion, 30% shadow, 70% light. Whatever it is, this portion here, 30% shadow, 70% light. If for example, we have more light and there's barely any shadow, we're going to take off that section. They say, for example, she's really bright and there's barely any shadows. We're going to look at the basic the portions and consider that principle. If we're talking about structure, okay, this is all just theory. My brain has always seen things in this way, and that's just something that made sense to me, like visually as a kid, and it's just coming to, like it's explaining it. It's the difficult part. What I did was, oh shoot, my computer wants to shut down. Hold on. Okay, going back to this portion. See your dress? It's like a bell. I'm gonna do this here. Okay. All right. It looks fine here, but when I flipped it, she looked off center. Like she wants to fall for some reason. In my brain, she's like, it felt like she wanted to, like she's going to fall. Like, I don't know what it is. Like there's some sort of weight issue happening. It looks all right. It looks all right. But I had to shave it off. I had to shave it off. Because if you look at the design, let's look at this. This shape here is equal to this shape, but she's facing three quarters, so this shape has to be thinner. Like it just jumped at me. Like it has to be slightly thinner, just to express that Fibonacci sequence, the golden ratio, thirds, three. It's just three. Thirds, you know what I mean? So now it feels a little more offset, a little more balanced to me. So when I flip it back, it's like the weight now is more balanced. Like there's more weight and yeah. Anyways,
Yeah, I don't know anything about flipping images.
It's.
I'm gonna get it tattooed on me.
You just gotta do it more. So yeah, so now she's doing more of this shape. What, like the whole idea of successful character design. First of all, most importantly, well, that can be debated, but very importantly is shape language. How is the character reading to you? Right now, as a basic shape, she's doing this. Like, overall, that's what she's doing. This is the center. Before, it was looking like this. Almost like this. But now, I'm expressing more of a 70-30. So, every bit of detail, all the elements, the soft part, the hard edge, the cast shadows, they all play into the rule of thirds, the golden ratio. That's why, you know, focal points are in the golden ratio. It's because nature works that way. Our focus just works that way in our head. 80-20, sure, that works. 64, just as long as not 50-50. But that's a rule of choice. At some, you know, at points you can do 50-50 if you want it. Preference.
I think 50-50 could work if you're doing a contrast piece.
Yeah, 50-50. Say, for example, I want to do evil this person. That becomes more of a statement now. See, that becomes a symbol of something. This is a symbol. I'm conveying a message. You know what I mean? There's no message. This is just replicating believable atmosphere. You know what I mean? Gesture. But yes, 50-50 comes more with more narration, narrative behind it.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, moving on. We got the core. So the core... that's going to be created with reflected light. So, we're going to do that. This is when we get into our lights. Soft light. I'm just going to do it. Soft light. I created the soft light automatically just by painting in the soft shadows. But if I wanted to have brighter lights, I'm going to do a soft light layer. Let's put that over here where it should be. These are all the lightings, so it's above the folder. This is going way longer than I expected, but this is good. This is good. Lights, I like to use skin tones just because they work well. Oh, no. That's for high spec lights. For regular soft lights, really dark values, close to dark black. So pretty much this one. I don't know what this was doing there. You use this big old spray can, and again, the same thing that we did with the soft shadows, we're doing with the soft light. So big, bright. In the layer... setting for that is color dodge. So color dodge, one big old bright for her head, a little bit soft overlay. For her
Some
shoulder.
Some people use overlay.
Some people use overlay, yeah. It use whatever you feel works for you. A little bit more here, not as much as her head, and just a touch here.
I feel like color dodge like really pulls out color more than overlay does, though.
Yeah.
Like it kind of like.
I know that
gives a bit of a glow.
The difference though is that one of them I'm not sure now doesn't go to pure white if you keep adding it. One of them doesn't go there.
Color dodge does that. Doesn't add to some colors, like for example, like I think reds and teals. I mean it for. For some reason, it doesn't affect it all the way. It'll just stay the same. So you have to paint in manually. And we'll get to that. But all right, so how did I apply this? Going back. 1, 2, 3. Okay. Big old bright balloon for the head. medium bloom for the chest, and even less for just a hint. I'm going to go back. Just a hint for hand. Again, rule of thirds. Rule of just great gradation, how things fade out into just a natural flow thing. Now, if watch this. If I were to go like this, the same strength as this, see how it throws it off? There's this light that hits her stomach. How can this light that hit her here be the same exact strength as it is here? It just doesn't work. See? So we have to consider, like, constantly. Thirds. It's 3, 4, 3, 3, 3.5. Around there. 64, 35. Yeah. If I do the hand, if I'm going to do the strong light, no, I'm just going to do a little bit like that. Just a hint. For the back, a little bit. Okay. We can also, on the same layer, give ourselves... No, we won't. So soft light. We'll write it down. I always do these same steps for my drawing. Soft light. And now we're going to do spec light, hard light, flat light, spec light. Just like we did with the cast shadows, this light is hard-edged. Okay?
Okay, so the soft light, I'm just, because it's my thing, mm-hmm. The soft light is not to be confused with reflected light.
Nope. Thank you. So I'm going to use a cast.
I only say that because we don't have soft light listed on the sphere, but we do have reflected light, so I just wanted to clear up any confusion.
Right. So there's, yeah, now we're just talking about stages here. Spec light, the soft light is...
That local color?
No, it's brighter than the local color. I'm going to do it. I haven't done it yet, actually. Let's edit it. So let's do it. I was debating whether or not putting it on the ball or not, but it's basically the transition from the high light to the local color. So this is the bright highlight close to white. It would be this yellow stuff. If it's white, if white is the spec light, the yellow would be the soft light. Let's get in there. I'm going to blend it down. This is soft light. And then the hard white, let's do white here, would be the spec light. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yeah, soft light. Thanks for pointing that out. Ah. Okay. Soft light, spec light. Let's do that. And now this portion. Oh yeah, I forgot to show you. Another way of doing the shadows is using the lasso tool, using the lasso marquee. Get to that with the L button, or find it over here. Let's go back to the shadows.
So when you added the soft light, it kind of softened up that shadow. Because remember when I said the shadow it looked really hard and everything else looked very soft. And now when I look at it, it's not as hard as it was.
Yeah, everything's blending in together. And
so that's interesting to note.
What I showed you, I'm not going to get to it. What I showed you about the Imperial's shadow and blending that shadow, you can also blend your hard lights. I'm going to show you right now. But we're going to lay down everything before we start blending, just to keep things in stages.
So you're adding all of your lights on top of your lines also, right?
Yes.
Okay, so there's that color variation that I was wondering about also in the actual lines, like how some of the lines are a little lighter where the light hits.
Mm-hmm. So I'm using this super bright gray. Let's not do that. Let's do even darker. Darker?
I'm trying to think of things that I've picked up along the way to point out.
Okay. Yeah. do that. So, in the color dodge, I forgot to mention, to get the dodge or the brightness to be dimmer, you want to go darker. So, if you're going to use white, this shade of gray, it's going to be pitch white. It's just white. If you go brighter, it's just going to be pitch white. Even if you go over here, it's going to be pitch white. If you want there to be some remnants of color or value, some remnants of value from your base color, then you have to go darker, almost close to black. That's a pink, not a white. Almost close to black, and it's still really bright. I mean, that's bright. You see? And I'm using this big old black color. See? See that? This is the color. But it's coming out very bright. So I'm going to lay that down there. A little bit for her eyes. A little bit for her nose. A little bit for her eyelashes. Just wherever I don't feel I know where the light's going to hit the hardest. Where the ridges of her skull is. This part right here is really oily. Crevice of her eye there. Maybe for her eyebrow? No.
Can you... So you're painting with almost black right now. Can you explain what it is about a hard... or about color dodge that would make... like the layer itself that would make that dark color come off so bright? Do you know the technical aspects behind it?
The technical thing about color dodge is just that... the thing is, the dodge is brightening up whatever color is underneath, right? That's what color dodge essentially does.
Mm-hmm.
And anything that's lighter, like if I'm using like this baby blue, it's going to come off as white. Like that's white. Like even the lines turn bright purple. So you want to stay closest to these really dark values. If you want to have, see how it is, it's nice and subtle. So if I use a big old soft brush and pulled out the soft lights using that color dodge, see? It's subtle. And that's where you want to stay. That's just how the color dodge works. I don't know why. It's just the way it is.
Okay. No, I was more interested to know if it was like subtracting colors or if it was like based off of what you have selected or what value you've selected or what the deal was there.
So let's finish the highlights. We'll put some highlights here. Oops. So finding the colors that you had can be difficult at this point because you want that. Let me show you a problem that I'd run into if I'm starting off. And a lot of people would. If you wanted that color and you chose like blue and you're like, I want that highlight back, but now I'm on blue and I've already used blue on, well, blue's gonna be blue. That's one of those weird ones. Use this one, or skin. Okay, skin. See, no, I want this one. I don't want this one. I want this one.
Jay, are you setting the layer for color dodge or using the brush as color dodge?
The layer. Okay. Now, if you're gonna paint everything on one layer, that's when you use brush settings.
Yeah.
If you're going separate layers, you want to have the layer settings. Now, to select a color, it's just basically selecting from that layer. The eyedropper, color pickup from layer. I want this dark gray, this really, really dark gray. See, it goes to transparent. Watch, keep your eye over here. It goes from dark gray to transparent because on this layer, there's nothing there except this dot or light that we're painting on for that hard light. That's the only thing. So it's picking up transparent color. So that's how you get your highlight back out. All right. Now it's beginning to look spotty. some color here for our jacket, some here for our jacket's already pretty bright. Usually when you reserve this these hard highlights for your really smooth surfaces like metals or skin or something oily like the skin, it could be for the hair. So reserve it for that. If this is like a black leather jacket, but again, that happens. I won't do an equal for this one. A little smaller and even smaller on that one. And a non-existent going down. We call that subtlety. Subtlety in detail. Subtlety. Subtlety. I think that's it for spec light. All right, moving on. Reflected light. Reflected light. 6. Reflected. Past tense. Reflected light. A lot of people will get, including me, the terminology incorrect. It's not reflective. It's not a reflective light. It's a reflected light. It's been reflected. So, again, we're going to do like what we did before. We're going to go big, soft, control dodge. Oh, new layer first. New layer, color dodge. Big, soft brush, spray can, or brush if you're using Photoshop. And we're going to use this dark value. And we're going to go to the opposite. If you notice here, if the light's coming from this here, the reflected light's gonna come from the complete opposite. Okay. And I'm gonna do this big soft bounce light from the ground that hits on this side light. Just on the base of her opposite. Keep it from looking really dark on the other side. So a little bit on this side, not as much. If you notice, this portion is a little darker than these guys down here. Okay? That's it. Maybe a little bit for the hair. If you wanna go crazy, then make it equal. make it equal if you want. But a lot of times you can tell amateur artists will make it equal throughout, equal. Here. It's just so stale because it's not doing what happens in nature. Things fade. Light fades. Things progressively gets weaker. Anyways, that's how you do it. And to emphasize that, okay, because it's not getting any brighter, no matter how much I'm pressing. So I'm going to have to go a little bit brighter there. And so that it doesn't get super bright, I'm going to press it slightly like that. So now our shadows are slightly brighter. Okay. We're going to clip it down. Okay, so you have to clip it down. Soft shadow. Oh. Soft reflected. I have to correct the term on the right, left, I mean. Light. Alright. So that's that. That's our soft reflected light. It's this big bloom of reflected light. Soft. Ah! Soft. Now, 7, what do you think it is?
Root beer. Nothing.
Hard reflected light.
Also known as rim lighting.
Rim lighting?
Yeah.
Not quite. Reflected light. Because, okay, like if you're looking at this, That's reflected, not quite rim light. Rim light would be this. Maybe it is. Maybe I'm wrong. I'm just saying this is from what I understand. I don't know how you understand it, but this is rim light. Usually it's a halo. It's a halo. So like if for example, the shadow's shadow's right in front of you. The rim light would be.
Yeah. It's the light lurking on the other side of the other form.
Side. Yes, it's the other side. We're lurking on the other side. Like it's like that. Let's use a more obvious color like blue. People like to do this. So this that's wrong. This blue. It's like he's facing us and there's like a bright light behind him. And he's got this like stink face, like he's looking at us. He's like, and the rim light would be the halo. That's halo, aka rim light. That I would agree with. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Rim light, but this one we're not having any rim light for this drawing. All right, so hard reflected light will be for comics. All right. For comics, this is where style comes in, and this is where you start breaking those rule of thirds. And the rule of thirds is just a method to keep things looking semi-realistic. And what you'll see with a lot of artists, a lot of people, they will have this bright, reflected light hitting just equal amounts, just all the way against the side. Now the thing about this, why it's not called rim light, is because this is another light source, or it is another light source. This is another light source from over there, like from the right side. So it's causing a reflected light. No, yeah, it's the balanced light. But what I'm doing right now is essentially creating another light source, a blue light. Which I guess would be called rim light then. If it is another light source, it would be a rim light. So I think that's what.
That would be the difference then.
Yes, the difference would be the light source. If it's a secondary light source, then it's a rim light. So yeah.
Okay. So what would a hard reflected light be then? What would that look like, as opposed to a rim light?
I guess you're right then. The hard reflected light that I'm creating is a rim light. So yeah, you got it. You got that one. There's no hard reflected light unless it is a rim light. I'm trying to think like right in this condition here, because the soft one.
This is a beautiful image, by the way.
Oh, thank you. Oh, yes. No. It would work under conditions without a secondary light as well. So, for example, you're looking at, let's say this was made out of leather, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna just take this dark color. Go look. Even darker than that. Yeah. See? I said darker just to get it lighter. You'll see this in figure drawings where the shadow contains this bright, like this shape in here. And it'll be really cut out. And that would create hard reflected lights. So what I'm doing right here, like right now. So like this? No, not this one. Like it would be created in pits. There would be a pit here, pit here, and those would create... it would be on this side, though. Let me show you. So, right here, watch. This is really, really getting to detail. With this color. Okay.
Well, we can save it for later. I was just doing my job of asking whatever questions I could
you
think
did a
of.
Good job, because what happens is, let me show you what happens. Hold on. That's what it is, these cache models. Okay. Because what happens when you do that, we start getting core shadows, and that's important. You'll find that in a lot of figure drawing courses when we actually etch the shadows like this. We etch them in, and this is what I was talking about on another method of finding your shadows. You etch them in, and then when you go in to fill them, they create this core shadow. You see? Light, core shadow, and then reflected light inside. Now, since we're using a digital technique, we would go in and paint in those colors. Like this. Watch. This. And that would be our hard edge reflected light. So I'm learning and refreshing my own kind of freaking memory too, so yeah. See, does that make sense? Like
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. So it would be here. That becomes really technical, and but I think it's important that we touch on it, because you'll see this you'll see this in comics a lot, where you have this reflected light happening there, this hard-edged reflected light happening there. And this is happening on the light side. All I'm over here, this is a blue secondary light, so it's actually blue. We wouldn't use this blue in this shadow, because this is reflected light, and this is a secondary light. Whew. There's a lot of information.
Yes, and before we disband, can you make a quick adjustment to like one of the flat layers so we can see like how it affects the hierarchy, how it affects the entire structure?
Oh, shoot. Hold on a sec. Where are my labels gone to today? Oh, shoot. Where?
What are you looking for?
Maybe this is it. I just turned it to. Nope, that's not it either. Let's just leave that as normal too, because I have not liked it. Maybe this is it. Normal? Nope. Looking for the words that I've been writing all along. You're on the left side.
Oh.
They're missing. Don't know how. Oh, no. Ricardo, you know where they go?
No, man, I didn't see them leave.
You clipped something at some point. What did you... You might have, like, clipped it out. I mean, you've clipped a few things. You might have accidentally written it on a layer and clipped them out.
Might have. Shoot.
Luckily, Nick Cage was kind enough to lay it all out for us, though, in the chat. Thanks, Nick Cage.
You guys, it's all recorded, so it'll be in the beginning. Let's just keep going. Reflected light. I think that's all of it. Let's keep going, though. Okay. So I'm gonna begin blending in some of the shadows that rounds off. I don't blend that. Maybe this portion here. So if that was like that, and if you wanted to keep it graphic and all those shadows looking 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, that's fine. Especially if it's just a rough draft. I wouldn't blend it in. I would do it for my final. But just for our example purposes, I use this water blend tool. Photoshop has it. You can also use a soft edge brush, which is what I'm going to use next, and blend it like this. Blend it like this. I'm going to hit it really quickly, some areas, just to keep that, again, rule of thirds. Like, I'll hit this portion and leave these parts out. So it's like a portion of it blended, a portion of it not. Creates focus, creates intention, creates all kinds of variation instead of just one stale, like, bang-a-bang. Like, if I were to do that, like, constantly everywhere, then it just defeats the purpose of, I mean, like, it becomes less interesting. Like, it starts looking, what's the term? What am I trying to find? I don't know. Anyways, let's keep going. So I wouldn't do it here, for sure, because that's going to be the cast shadow. So keep in mind, like, where you want the cast. Like, I wouldn't do it here, because then it's no longer a cast. I can do it here, because it rounds off the inform, and it turns into a cast shadow. So this is hard edge, soft edge. Soft edge, that's not a light source, okay. Hard edge, soft, hard. Notice that? Soft, hard. Soft, it would be hard over there. Soft, hard.
Yeah, I think that's one of my problems, is like I get into this automated mode where I just start blending everything and I don't take the time to stop and think about that.
Yeah, it's just a matter of restraint, because we want to always just like go all the way and keep going. Like, I have the same problem. It's like some people will stop at a certain point because of choice. They're like, I like this 2D look. I can't. I always end up over-rendering, and it's just something we do because it's just fun to practice. We're doing something that we're practicing something that we do. Anyways, yeah, that's that. And already it's starting to look too blended, like especially around here. I like that kind of. Like hard edge, soft edge, like that. That's enough. I just hit it here and there. Just really soft. Less is more, if you guys ever heard that. Okay, we're gonna go up to the hard light. Hard light, I'm gonna hit this side, not the other side. Hit these guys out and then blend out these guys even more harder. So you can see this part is the hardest edge, so this is where our focus is. Everything else should be more blended out than the rest, and it creates a focus right there. Like, oh, this is the hardest. Now, to finish it off, sometimes if you're using a color and it's not turning white, let's see, in this case, is it going to turn white? Yes, it is. Some colors like teal, I don't think teal, if you had teal underneath, perfect, we have teal for her eyes. We had teal, and I was to use this bright gray, it should turn white. And it does, great. I don't know what it is. One of the colors don't. Very strange. But if that doesn't happen, create a new layer, keep it a normal like this, just normal, clip mask it, and paint it in manually. Just choose white, just straight white. This is going to be our whites. That's the brightest parts, creating the most attention. So I'm going to hit this side of the eye and then this side of the eye. And I'm starting to break rules of comic, because comics is like, they're pretty much equal in tone, which is fine. But what can we do to express that rule of thirds? We can do a smaller circle. And that just gives us the expression of having it less bright. And I can add a little bit of dark line here. Just watch what happens. I do that. That when I pull out, the highlight looks extra bright. because it creates a strong contrast. Right next to that white, there's a dark color instead. Oh, shoot. That's the wrong... Gosh, wrong word! It's transparent. There. Okay. There. What else can we do? Blah, 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 blah. Oh, okay. Now, we're going to do what you were talking about. Actually, first, before we do that, we are going to soft reflect light her scarf. And I'm using a dark red. Get this nice warm thingy thing. If I were to use gray, dark gray, dark black, it still would be pretty warm. That's warm compared to this desaturated gray tone. This is much warmer than that. And that's the beauty of color dodge. It automates something that old traditional artists do manually. If you have this shadow, you would go brighter but warmer. We talked about that, right, John?
Yeah.
Yeah, we know all about that. So in this, you can also use a really dark red and really amp it up just to give it extra warmth. Like there's something warm. And that's nice too, because she's a good guy, by the way. Okay, yeah, that's that. Maybe a little bit here. See, rule of thirds. It's bugging me. I'm going to show you what I'm talking about. It just happens. This moment where I say, no, this isn't thirds yet. And I'm not. I don't mean it literally. When I say thirds, I mean like, you know, like it's more than 50-50. It's split. Like, you know what I mean? So here it is. We see some light hitting here and none over here. So now it looks like 50-50. If you squint your eyes, this portion is partially lit, while this is not. So if I'm going to fix that, I'm just going to punch a little bit right there. Bow. So it transitioned over there. So now we have 30% shadow, 70% light. Constantly thinking about that. All right. Now, for the most rewarding part, I'm going to put this all, everything, into one folder. So this folder, including all this stuff highlighted all, shift and click the topmost, drag them all in there, close it. Now we're going to duplicate this. Now, this is where your colors, your separating layers pay off. And how in comics this will really help, because for example, I don't like the color of her hair, or I don't like the color of her jacket, or the client says I want these things to be darker. I want to play around more with the colors. Now you can actually go in and change the colors. Still have all the lights be the same. So all your lights are affecting the color the same exact. You're not repainting those lights in. And that's really the most rewarding part, is that you don't have to repaint those values in. Now, if you were to paint on one layer, all of these colors, like a traditional artist, would be picked manually. This and we had a debate about this one, Ricardo. This purple turns into a warm blue, and then it turns into like a greenish blue, and in this case, it's baby blue. So dark blue into a baby blue. Those colors would be manually picked, but Color Dodge does all of that for us. I want her to have a dark jacket. This the whole way. I'll do this all off air, and I'll turn it to my client. Turn it in for my client to look at. So now, if I'm going darker like this, you start to see how you can push the shadows and colors a little more. So for that one, Since the jacket's so dark, we're going to use the line layers as multiply. We're going to multiply it so it multiplies against the dark coat. Since this one is a lighter value, we can work with lighter lines. Just because that contrast between the black and the light, it really throws my eye off. But if it's a darker color, then we can get away with it. But since everything's darker in value, we can go in and mess with the lights respective to that layer. So we can play with it more. See how that really stands out? It doesn't work. So you have to like really just throw it in hard up here. So it becomes more, faded. Rule of thirds. Rule of thirds. I'm going to hit a little bit there, and just maybe a little hint there. No, that's terrible. See, it wouldn't get that bright down here. Up here, we might get away with it. But definitely, it's fine up here. And that's causing this gradation. I won't keep that, though. I will not keep that. If I wanted to be more exact, I would use a darker value gray. See? Keep things subtle. Work. Build it up slowly. Build it up gradually. Like that. If you want it brighter, go brighter. If you don't want it to go brighter, don't. I forgot. This part's actually supposed to be a patch over her arm. But that's gonna mean another layer for the one of the flats. I'm gonna have to create another layer for the flats. And that's gonna do a lot more stuff. So that's it. That's everything I have to teach, man. There's no more Jetty Jet show.
And that's a wrap.
And that's a wrap. So yeah.
You burned everything in one day, in one session.
Oh shit, yeah.
Damn.
So any questions?
None that I can think of. Well, actually, I do have one. So, say, because this is all for comic books,
mm-hmm.
Say if you had, let's just say the two that you have on the left are twin sisters and they're in the same panel. Would it be okay for the lines for one to be red and the lines on the other one to be black? How do you feel about that? I don't think so either.
Keep them all black. They would have to be, yeah. But if it stands alone as it is like this, sure. But yeah, I think they would all have to be one solid color to keep things unified.
Okay, that's the end of my dumb questions.
Yeah. Not dumb at all. That's a very good question. Damn, how long did I go for? Square once
way past my bedtime.
I knew.
You went for some. Damn. Two hours.
Two hours.
I did all this for you, right, Ricardo?
Yeah, well, it was different. When it did it for me, it was a little bit different.
It was?
And this was more direct. We were alone and we kind of talked about a lot more stuff, and we did like black and white first, and then we experiment with color layers and stuff like that.
Yeah. Oh, I forgot. Also for the highlights for the face.
But it's a really cool base, though. You can kind of.
There's a lot more you can do with this. Yeah, you can you begin to play with it yourself and evolve and use new techniques.
Yeah, I kind of created my own way of doing it now. Mm-hmm. So it was really helpful to have something to start from. It was really, really helpful. Yeah, man, I owe you that one for sure.
A whole video based on it, so thanks, man. No problem.
Yeah.
You were like saying, Jed, help me. I was like. It up a bit. And it can get really severe. Like once you start getting hang of it, you begin to render things like crazy, and you're like, there's no end to it. to render it all until the lines go away. That depends on your preference. If you, for example, sketch your drawing, and then you clean, like really, really clean lines with inks, because these lines are not clean, these are all rough lines, then I would not remove the lines, because what will be the purpose of cleaning the lines if you're going to get rid of them? Making a decision between keeping your lines or painting them out. In this case, if you want to paint out your lines, I would suggest keeping really loose, scrappy, ugly lines, and then you paint them out. And that really, that's effective.
Yeah.
I mean, the energy in the drawing. Yeah?
I like the sketchy lines.
Oh, I like the sketchy lines, too. Just saying, in case you need a method for painting out the lines, that's how I would go about doing it. And I didn't get yelled at. I was talking hella loud.
No, this was super helpful, Jet. Thank you.
You're welcome, man. Going to call it a night. We are done. Any last words, you guys? No?
Just
keep practicing, man. Do your thing. Do your thing, everybody. And enjoy your wonderful night, morning, wherever you guys are. I don't know who you would be nice to find that. And that's fine. I usually end it with a peace.